heaven or anywhere you have no comparison. And this is why on this special occasion we call upon you that Father, you will rescue Nigeria.
Amen.
Lord, you will heal Nigeria.
Amen.
Lord, we call upon you in your mercifulness that you redeem Nigeria.
Amen.
Rescue us from perishing.
Amen.
Grant, O Lord, as we enter into 60th anniversary, it will be a glorious new beginning.
Amen.
And you will do what no man can do unto us.
Thank you, Father.
We trust you will do for us more than we can think or ask or do. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
If you see that, it's a great honor and privilege for us to ask to worship with you today on this very important occasion of the Independence Service of Nigeria. And I want to express very profound gratitude to the chaplain, the very Reverend Oligadu, the assistants, the chairman of the chapel committee, Professor Alex Kaido, and all committee members, and all clergy assisting, and all ministers here present. The grace of God shall never depart from you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let me salute the wisdom in the choice of him we have sung today. Those songs are a message themselves, appropriate message for this occasion. With those hymns, we don't need another message. With those hymns, we don't need another prayer. Especially the special anthem rendered by the choir. That is an appropriate prayer for our country, Nigeria. I want to bless the name of the Lord for all of you there in that choir store and those who chose to be for our family. We want to be to enrich you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You will permit me because last week we were not all around you at Asaba. And I was there, grandmother, professor. Show me, Professor Cannon, show me, did her 80th birthday.
Yes.
And she was very happy. And she was happy with her for you. God has given you long life. What we now pray is that he will give you longer life.
Yes.
And enjoy the fruits of your labors, yes, even in the land of the living, in the name of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
You know what? Over the past 1 week, or thereabouts, we have been celebrating Nigeria's 59th independence anniversary, October 1, 1960. If I ask those of us who were born before October 1960 to raise up our hands, half of this chapel would have been born after October 1960. Independence from British colonial rule. Every year since then, on this special day, we celebrate, or at least we take out time to reflect on the life of Nigeria, the nation. And I guess the National Day Service of the Chapel of the Resurrection is one of the loftiest platforms that God has given us to both celebrate and to reflect on the life of this great nation. Perhaps someone is wondering here, of what significance is a single chapel and a single university in the matters of a complex and diverse nation like Nigeria? Let me remind such a person here today that this University of Ibadan, first and best, where tertiary education and by extension homegrown intellectualism began in 1900. It is just that we are a nation that does not value legacies or heritage. As modern cars have brainwashed, you are is Nigeria's brainwash. You are is a legacy that should be treasured. You are is a legacy that should be valued. You are is a legacy that should be nurtured and given its pride of place. But whether it is acknowledged or not, the fact remains that till today, this university has the capacity to exert a great influence on the nation Nigeria. Take it or leave it, she has the capacity to exert that on the nation. Our next point is the significance of this chapel. Chapel of the Resurrection, you are. Many great things in Nigeria and beyond started from this chapel. Not only from this chapel, it actually started from this pulpit. Simple as it looks. Many great things that happened in Nigeria started from here. For example, our present primate was the leader of the student wing, the SCM, in this chapel about 40 years ago. The same goes for the current Christian Association of Nigeria president. This chapel was the crucible that formed him, and many other great ministers of God. Things have been said from this pulpit or done from this pulpit in time past which have ripple effects across the entire length and breadth of Nigeria and perhaps beyond. Of course, those who have come with one or two unpleasant consequences in the past, it did happen, though painful. But from this place, a lot has touched Nigeria. Some prophets of our time have actually spoken from this pulpit, from this chapel, and because of the impact of their words, the leaders of our nations have acted like some wicked kings to them. Such as we found in the Bible, who imprisoned and beheaded prophets for saying the gospel truth. We are thankful to God that we are now in a democracy, so to say. And we expect our leaders to respect human rights. But even if they will not, we are at a critical time in the life of a nation where we must speak to the nation like Prophet Samuel spoke. In 1 Samuel chapter 11 and verse 14, come and let us go to Gilgal and renew the kingdom at Gilgal. 1 Samuel chapter 11 verse 14. Nigeria is our own Gilgal. This chapel and university is our own Gilgal. Let us from here make the necessary sacrifices for the renewal of our nation, Nigeria. The first step is to say it as it is. There is trouble in the land. So, I don't know whether you have observed, year after year, one terrible thing comes to Nigeria. Some years back, it was Boko Haram. Some years back, it was kidnapping that matters, and so on and so forth. And this year, another one came from South Africa. I don't know how to pronounce that word. Year after year, take a look back many years back. It had been like that. And on the face value, one can easily say it is because of our sin. Maybe we are being punished because of that. If we attempt to describe the trouble in its totality, we will not live here today. We are in a lot of trouble. But there is no need. Because all we feel at all times, no one who does not feel it in one way or the other. The unrest in Nigeria is no longer something you just hear or see on television. Every single family has felt it in one way or the other, no matter how high placed. Even the village of the president of this nation has felt it. She's got his own share. Maybe it is good anyway, so that they can know how it feels. And one of the village men was kidnapped. So let us just call it to say that we are where we are today because even though we are such highly religious people, we have at the same time become such an ungodly people. Terribly ungodly. What a contradiction. But that is our story. That is us. At various national discourses, people have spoken and spoken about the need for restructuring in the nation. Restructuring, which is good. And we support it 100%. But if we restructure Nigeria and we don't first restructure our public morality, and you send the big thieves in Abuja, whose slogan is empty fair, if you send them to the regions, they will finish the regions in no time. They will steal everything in quick time. And their greed will still not be satiated. If you restructure Nigeria and you don't restructure our public morality, clannishness and nepotism will merely change garment. They will change uniform. Fulani versus Igbo will stop trending. And we will now have Okigwe versus Isialamba. We will now begin to have Ijebu versus Eba. TV versus Idoma. On a more deadly scale, let me emphasize. When you restructure Nigeria without first restructuring our public morality, some people in some places will now have unlimited freedom to award university degrees to those who cannot spell the word university. Maybe it's already been happening. Maybe it's already happening. Universities are now becoming nonsense schools. But thank God, this place, you can't change it for the worst. It will always excel. And whoever will not make this place to excel, to be different, God will send the person on transfer. Some of you didn't say amen. Amen. How can you award degree to somebody who cannot spell you mean? You mean not And it's as if very soon it will either collide with a tree or fall off a cliff. The church needs to rise and not just show the way, but actually lead the way. We must stop the driver. The place we are taking this motor to is just stop. And if we cannot stop him, let us go and remove him. There's a difference between stop and remove, have you? It's a lighting way. If we cannot stop him, let us find a way of removing the driver before he plunges, or maybe before she plunges. Before they plunge this nation into more trouble, the church needs to rise and not just show the way, but actually lead the way. We must, by the help of God, redirect the box in which we all are in. We must take it back to the road, whether it is bumpy or not. It's even better to be on that road, no matter how bad the road is, than over the cliffs. We must raise new drivers who will not drive the bus into the bush again. Where should we start from? The Holy Bible, 2 Chronicles 7:14, is my people who are called by my name. Shall I do what? And do what? And turn from their wicked ways. Then God will do what?
Yes.
And will heal our land. That is one prayer we must pray every day individually. Healing for our land. Healing. People who just die for no just good reason. Their blood is crying for vengeance. Let God heal our land. The Bible also says in Proverbs 14:34, righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. So while the politicians are busy trying to solve the perceived political problem, the church must arise much more urgently and more decisively to address the nation's great problems. Let us say bluntly here. Our people are religious, but again, we are ungodly. The death of our religious, our being godly, is just religion. Look, let's face the truth. What most Christians of today in Nigeria know is their pastors, not God. It's their pastors. And no longer knowing God. Cannot see your pastor, cannot worship. If your pastor never said, the Bible has not said. That is how far we have gone astray. We are the pastors, but we know God. We obey the pastors, but we obey God. Those are the crucial issues we must face in order to occupy the proper position to redeem that boss from blowing over the cliff. And we need to urgently rewrite the scripts if Nigeria will have peace and progress. Isaiah 58:1-2. Cry aloud, spare not. Lift up thy voice like a trumpet, and show my people their transgression, and the house of Jacob of their sins. Yet they seek me daily, and delight to know my ways, as a nation that did righteousness, and forsook not the ordinance of their God. They ask of me the ordinances of justice. They take delight in approaching to God. In that chapter 58, Isaiah enumerates for us the practical things that a truly God-fearing people should be found doing, and what we may describe as basic altruism, rather than vain worship. We are full of vain worship in this country, devoid of any altruism whatsoever. The issues that Isaiah listed are many. Justice for the poor and the weak, mercy and truth, fighting oppression, care for the hungry and the poor, promotion of public decency and morality. We are not high on our shopping list at all as a nation. And if they are on our list at all, most of these things are not there. I said I will not describe our trouble, but it is hard to resist the temptation. Those of you who are active on social media will have read many trending posts in the last few weeks that describes the many little things, but very bad things, that we do at home, which we will not do once we land in the UK or the USA. Things like flinging plastic bottles out of our bedroom on the road, flinging nylon paper or akara nylon paper as you go on the sea. Things like urinating and defecating by the roadside. Oh yes, this thing happened. Initially, it is not humans that do that. You know those who do that. No, 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 don't say it, don't say it. We know those who do that. Things like refusing to renew your table particulars. Things like refusing, or let us put it into another word, forgetting to pay your utility bills. Not refusing this time, maybe you forgot. And at the same time, you are using all those benefits. Until the other lane is blocked. It's common sight neighbors who are not expecting. It's becoming a common sight in the city too. Things like the traffic light has shown red, and that is when you go. Well, of course, there is no traffic light again in the city. We trust that our new governor will resurrect all of this. And yet we all wonder why Nigeria is the way it is. It is the accumulation of the little things, the wicked ways of 200 million people. It's the accumulation. You do your own, I do my own. Nobody sees us. We are all accumulating. And that's why we are here today. And that is why peradventure, we cannot even speak to those who are stealing our money with their legs. Those who are storing our money in the stomach of snakes. The whole thing is gone too bad. And we become a laughing stock all over the world. How can a snake swallow millions? They have come off the bamboo. You know the kind of people they come from, but people who don't know anything. That's why they come off. Where is that story today? It's gone. It's gone. No justice. drops of water make a mighty ocean.
Yes, sir.
Our tiny drops of personal wickedness and misbehaviors have been pitched to this nation. A tank bomb that is waiting to explode. And unless we change, people of God, there are nations where people do not go to church today. Whether in the day or in the night, like we do here, but they don't tell lies. They don't go to church, but they don't tell lies. They don't go to church in the daytime or in the night, and they don't take bribes. They don't litter the road with all sorts. Maintenance culture is number one to them. And they don't go to church. They arrive on time for any engagement. They arrive on time. They arrive before time. But we pray a lot. And we do a lot of gymnasium. I hope I'm correct with that word.
Yes.
Gymnastic, thank you, ma'am. That's why I have that. I'm afraid to go on a big chair. We pray a lot. We sing in tongues. We quote many verses of scripture. And then we do other things. And God has not permitted. We demand and receive bribe. Okay, we don't demand or take bribe, but we jump the queue regularly. Line up in this place. You come with your brother or with your brother, and you take over. You are going, who you be? Those who were there before, you know, be human beings, they be. Simple, pure. But no. And on Sunday, your own dancing is first class in the congregation. With your lives, with impunity. And then, when it all adds up to give us a nation full of evil, we begin to complain. Let us quit complaining. Let us change. One person at a time, and then pray to Jehovah. The wise man listening to what he writes in Proverbs 16, 6 to 8. By mercy and truth, iniquity is purged. And by the fear of the Lord, men depart from evil. When a man's ways pleases the Lord, when a woman's way pleases the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be pleased. Better is a little with righteousness than great revenues without wrath. Let us, children of God in this nation, become standard bearers in Nigeria. Let us deliberately and decisively arise to shine the light of Jesus Christ. Let great examples of good living be seen in our lives. Virtuous living be multiplied in our midst. You don't know what our Lord told us. He said to us, you are the light of the world. You are the salt of earth. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. Matthew 5 from verse 13. That's what the Lord said. And I want you to know that a city that is set on an hill cannot be hid. Let your light shine. This little light of mine, let us decide for the day and we're going to let it shine. I have to say that the problem is not out there. The problem is in here. The strong writer said, one with God is church. The problem is not we are outnumbered.
No!
The issue is that unless we stand up for Jesus, we will not stand out. It is only when we stand for Jesus that we are able to stand out. And it is only then this nation will begin to change. Daniel stood to be counted. And listen to what his enemy said in Daniel chapter 6, verse 5. We shall not find any occasion against this Daniel, except we find it against him concerning the law of the God of Israel. Daniel combined copious worship with basic integrity in public service. Fear of God. He was one with God. And he became the majority. One with God became the majority. So it is not a question of, I can't do it alone. Yes, you can do it alone. You can be an example from today. And multitudes will begin to follow you. Yes, it earned Daniel a majority. Even though he had the consequences that he had to spend a night with the lions. And this is what the Bible said in Daniel 6:25. After that encounter, then King Darius wrote unto all people, nations and languages that dwell in the earth, peace be multiplied unto him. I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom, men tremble and fear before the God of Daniel. One man's action brought that to be. For all he went out, he is the living God. The king testified, an unbeliever, he is the living God, and steadfast forever, and his kingdom, that which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall be even unto the end. He delivereth and rescueth. And he worketh signs and wonders, both in heaven and on earth, who had delivered Daniel from the powers of the lions. So this Daniel, Bible added, so this Daniel prospered in the reigns of Darius and in the reign of Cyrus, the Persian. People of God, the problem is not that Cyrus